But I think sometimes we kind of expect God to be like a vending machine, and that's not how it works. So it's like, well, if I do the right thing and I check all these boxes and I put my quarters in, I'm going to get out what I'm asking for. But there's an element here of having to realize the unfathomable nature of our finiteness in comparison to the immeasurable nature of God's infiniteness.
Actually, God's probably saying you're doing okay, because he's not saying anything to us. I think that says you're doing okay. God's saying, I trust you and you're on the right path.
Beyond what we feel, things are being done. God does see you. He does hear you. Your prayers that are in alignment with the will of the Lord for your life are being answered.
It set me up to understand who I was and my true identity and my true value, because a lot of times in the Christian community, people didn't perceive me the right way, or they would see the way I dress. You know, I wear the scarves and jewelry, and then they would not take the time to come to know me, and then they would just think I'm just this shallow guy because of the way I dress, just because I like fashion or whatever. But Kim just always saw me for who I was, and he actually saw the anointing that was on me when a lot of other people that had less spiritual awareness wouldn't see it, and they would misjudge me, and they would keep me out of things because, oh, who's this Zoro guy with the hat and the whatever. And Kim wasn't that way. He loved me for who I was. He saw me for who I was. And I can't say enough great things about how that changed the trajectory of my life.
House of Destiny, worship again. And I'm so excited because we get an opportunity really to press into the presence of the Lord, get to know him better, let him speak to us. And so I just welcome you to posture your heart to receive. We receive from you today, Lord. And we love you so much for your presence.
He shames every idol. He reigns without rival. He goes by the name of Jehovah, Jehovah. He speaks into nothing, and darkness goes running. He goes by the name of Jehovah, Jehovah. Call the name, call the name, call the name, Jehovah. All our praise, all our praise, all our praise belongs to him. It all belongs to him. Yeah. His foes will be silenced. He's fighting for Zion. There's no other God like Jehovah, Jehovah. His arm never tires. His eyes are like fire. There's no other God like Jehovah, Jehovah.
Let's sing it together.
See, fight your battles. Jehovah Jireh, meet your needs. Jehovah Rapha, heal your body.
Jehovah Shalom be your peace. Oh, oh, oh.
Jehovah Nissi, fight your battles. Jehovah Jireh, meet your need. Jehovah Rapha, heal your body. Yeah. Jehovah Shalom be your peace. Yeah, yeah. Jehovah Nissi, fight your battles. Oh, oh, oh.
He's gonna meet you right where you are.
Jehovah Rapha, heal your body.
Yeah, yeah.
Jehovah Shalom be your peace. Yeah, yeah. Jehovah Nissi, find your battles. Jehovah Jireh, meet your need. I've never seen the righteous forsaken. Jehovah Rapha, heal your body by his stripes. Jehovah Shalom be your peace. So we sing, call the name, call the name, call the name, Jehovah. All our praise, all our praise, all our praise belongs to him. Yeah. Call the name, call the name, yeah, yeah, call the name,
Jehovah.
Yeah. Jehovah Jireh, meet your need. Yeah. Jehovah Rapha, heal your body. Yeah, yeah. Jehovah Shalom, be your peace. Yeah. Jehovah Nissi, fight your battles. He's never lost. Jehovah Jireh, meet your need. Yeah. Jehovah Rapha, heal your body. Jehovah Shalom, be your peace. Jehovah Nissi.
Jehovah Nissi, find your battles.
He's never lost a battle.
Jehovah Jireh, meet your
never
peace.
Seen his children begging for bread. Jehovah Rapha, heal your body. Yeah. Jehovah Shalom, be your peace.
So call the name. Call the name.
Yeah, sing it.
Call the name, Jehovah. All our praise, all our praise, all our praise belongs to him.
Yes, God. You're strong and mighty, Lord. We lean in and we trust a strong and mighty God. Not a weak king. You're a king who reigns forever.
When all I see is the bad, you see my victory. When all I see is the mountain, you see a mountain. And as I walk through the shadow, your love surround me. Yeah. There's nothing to fear now, for I am safe with you. So when I fight on my knees with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. And every fear I lay at your feet, I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. And if you are for me, who can be against me? No one else. For Jesus, there's nothing impossible for you.
When all I see are the ashes, you see the beauty.
you see the empty tomb. So when I fight on my knees with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet. I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Oh, an almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine through the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God.
Almighty fortress,
you go before us.
You go before us.
Yeah, yeah.
Nothing can stand against the
nothing,
power
nowhere.
Of our God. You shine in the shadows.
You win every battle. Nothing can stand. You turn it for good, oh, you turn it, say you turn it, you turn it for good, you turn it for good, oh, you turn it for good, you turn it for, you turn it around for me, oh. Turn it.
see a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. We're gonna see a victory, we're gonna see a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. It belongs to you, Lord.
Hello, dear friends, House of Destiny. What a joy it is to gather together. We are an eternal family, and we're sharing eternal life together. And God has strengthened us and gifted us with the ability to go around the world with the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ. It's our offering time, and that's why we're giving. God doesn't need our money. We're giving so that we can do His work. And God uses the seed that you sow to produce a bountiful harvest in your life. And I just want to encourage you, because even in these difficult times, God is going to bless you in a bountiful way. Seeing through the eye of faith is so different than just looking through the natural. You know, it says in 1 Timothy 6, it says, don't fix your hope on the uncertainty of riches. Everything in this world is broken. Everything in this world is uncertain. People that have wealth are going to lose it. But your wealth, which comes from God, can never be corrupted. And God is just going to add and multiply and increase in your life. And I want to speak that blessing over you today as we go before the Lord, not only in prayer and worship, but with the sacrificial giving. I encourage every one of you to release your faith in God in a financial way, because He wants to prove Himself in the famine. He wants to prove Himself in the lean. He sent Joseph to Pharaoh, and God blessed Pharaoh abundantly because of the blessing of heaven that was on Joseph's life. And God is going to bless the people in your world abundantly because of the blessing that's on your life. He's going to bless you. Heavenly Father, I pray now as we come together and we unite to sow our seed, because You are so good and because You are deserving. And we want to declare from the rooftops that You are our source, God. You are our source. And that's why we give. That's why we tithe. That's why we sow, away from ourselves, to say, see, this is how the miracle not only happens, but continues to happen. Now bless Your people, Lord, and do it in unexpected ways as You so creatively do. In Jesus' powerful name, and everybody said, so be it.
They have said that on October 4th of this year at 2:20, okay, p.m. Eastern time, this is what's going to happen. Every phone and TV in the USA is going to be blacked out temporarily. Now, what they have said is that this is going to last for only a minute. Well, why are you doing this? Why are you blacking out every phone, every television? So that means internet streaming, that means radio broadcasting. I believe everything is going to be blacked out. So people are asking the question, why? What they have said is this: we are testing the system. Well, why? Why are you testing this system? Why are you going to black out everything?
Welcome to Conversations. Well, today we've got a very special guest. His name is Zoro, and we have known him for a number of years, actually all the way back to 2009 when we first met Zoro, Kim and I. And, you know, Zoro is an incredible drummer. And, of course, I've got two sons who absolutely love Zoro and listen to all of his drumming and absolutely love you, Zoro. So welcome to Conversations.
Well, it is awesome to be with you guys and to be reunited with one of the first families of the prophetic world and one of the greatest families I know. just warms my heart to be back with you guys. I have such incredible memories of being with all of you over a period of many years since I first met you in 2009. And I'm going to start off by sharing a little secret that the Lord just dropped in my spirit as you were getting ready to talk. I had remembered something, and I don't know if I ever shared this before, but I met you guys in 2009 in Nashville when Kim was there at the TBN studios and he prophesied over me and the family. But long before then, in 1995, I went to a Kim Clement meeting in Northridge, California. And this is my first awareness of him. And I sat in the very back of the venue, and Kim did his thing and played the piano and prophesied, and it was amazing. But I said a prayer in the back of the room, the very back of the auditorium. I said, "Lord, if you could make it possible, one day I'd like to meet this guy. I'd love to become a friend of his." I just immediately clicked with Kim's energy, with his vibe, with his musicianship, and I was as far from him as I could possibly be at the back of that venue, but I serve a God who hears the prayers no matter where you're at, and I prayed, "One day if you could make it possible for me to meet this guy, I would really appreciate that." That was in 1995. I just realized that while you were waiting to talk, and I was thinking, oh my God. It all goes back to that prayer that I prayed that I could meet Kim. And God has done things like that in my life that are supernatural and miraculous. And then in 2009, through our friend, another prophet and guitar player, Marty Layton, is the one who brought us to the TBN studios and invited us. And Marty was playing guitar with you that night, and he's the one who made the introduction. So, and then that's the very night we met. After he prophesied over me and my family, I had never even met him yet, but he'd already had that amazing word for us that's literally changed our life. And many of the viewers might not know that I was with Kim for several years, playing percussion with him and traveling around the world with him at different prophetic events. During that period when I was with Kim was one of the most special and important and fulfilling times of my life as a musician, as a minister. And Kim was one of the first guys to really sow into Zoro International Ministries and get behind me, my vision for ministry, my SOAR book. So it's very special to be on this broadcast now after having not seen you guys for several years, because there's nothing that I do that Kim Clement isn't a part of because of how much he poured into me, sowed into me, invested in me as a person, as a musician, as a minister. So I'm honored to be here.
Great. Well, we're honored to have you. I mean, you know, there's so many, Kim's ministry touched so many lives, and it's so important for us to remember how, you know, one person can reach out and touch so many people. And all of us, we have the ability to do that ourselves in our evangelistic approach to winning souls for the Lord. And, you know, it's just amazing. Your testimony is amazing.
Well, thank you. And it continues, right? We're a living testimony until we're not here anymore. But Kim was a perfect example of somebody who utilized every moment to make a difference. Every moment, wherever he went, he was making a difference. And that's something we can all do, whether we're prophetic or not, is just living in that moment of knowing, hey, everywhere you go, you have a chance to change the world by being kind, by being loving, by being merciful and compassionate and graceful, just exemplifying the Lord of God wherever you go. It's that St. Francis of Assisi quote, "Preach the gospel at all times, and if necessary, use words."
Perfect. Yes, that's absolutely perfect. Well, listen, Zoro, you've brought some clips to play for us today of what my dad prophesied over you. And I'm so excited. I haven't seen, so I'm so excited to see it. I don't think I've ever seen. I remember him going on and on about you. My father just loved you. He just, anytime I heard, who's the Zoro? Because I didn't meet you until later. So I kind of missed out on some of that stuff there, you know, when he first met you. But I'm so interested to see this. So you said you have a video clip to play. And yeah, what is the date?
It is March 13th, 2009. And my kids were very, very young at the time. Now they are 24 and 21, but they were born in 1999 and 2001. So they were pretty young, but it's astounding some of the things he said about them without knowing them. He never met them a day in his life, you know, and he didn't know them from a hole in the wall. So whatever he said is what God clearly showed him. And we'll watch the first clip and then let's unpack it. And I'll share with you my perspective on that now.
Zoro, the Spirit of the Lord tells me to tell you, you have not come for any other purpose but to touch God. But also, you have blessed His prophet, and God wants to bless you as well. Your children are very particularly talented, have a very particular course that they will go on. Your family has been set aside and designed long before you were born. For nations, not just this nation. You see, there are nations that are dead to the preaching of the gospel, but they are not dead to the sound of God in music. And God said the sound of music, God in music, will bring those of Europe, Scandinavia, Asia, and many other parts of the world, including Africa, huge one. Those places you must go to, for I'm dispersing this gift. How will I do it? By my provision. It shall be a family thing. You will not be taken away like you have, because the Lord says this shall be done not only by your physical appearances, but by the prospering of your product. Because God says, I'm putting it on the internet and I'm going to send it out where interest shall suddenly grow and grow and grow. Because there shall be miraculous undertakings as you prophesy on your instrument and speak out as God told you to speak out, says the Lord. Because you were like Jeremiah. You didn't think you could do it because you didn't have enough experience, perhaps, or even didn't have the knowledge. But the Spirit of the Lord said, I'm doing what I did with Jeremiah in your life. I'm sending you as a prophet to those that are on in kingship in their own kingdoms, in music and all over the world. I am anointing you as a prophet to those nations. When you strike, God says something shall change in the atmosphere and people shall suddenly turn around and say, what just happened? You will have that power, says the Spirit of God. Let not the unbelief that has come across your way stop you from running, because God said, I will write the check myself and send you as I promised I would do right from the beginning, says the Spirit of God. Come on, give Him a shout.
Wow. I have seen that before. I remembered as soon as I started watching it. Okay, so what do you have to share about that, Zoro? I'm so interested to hear what you have to say now, seeing that as well.
So many things he touched upon on that particular one. Then we'll watch the other one, the second one, in a minute. But one of the first things that really touched me is the first line he said, you have not come for any other purpose but to touch God, but you have also blessed His prophets. So that spoke volumes to me. Like God created me to, I mean, God creates us for different reasons, but He ultimately creates us for His pleasure. So for Him to say you came for no other reason other than to touch God. One of the things I've had my entire life is a very tender heart, a very soft heart towards God, and wanting to make a difference and do things that please Him. And so I've always been a guy who's just all about heart. But for Him to say that made me kind of feel validated, because I grew up fatherless, so I never had the love of a father. But for the Lord to say, you've come for no other purpose but to touch God. Then He went on to say, your children are very particularly talented, have a very particular course they will go on. Well, that has proven to be true for both of my children. They're both very, very talented. My son's name is Jared. My daughter's name is Jordan. And they have been on a very, very particular course. The other thing that he said about the drums, playing the drums, and that I would prophesy through the drums. I've played all over the world, and the drums have been a thing that have broken through. And I've had people, after this prophetic word, I've had people that heard me play on an internet broadcast, and they would say to me, "There's something that when you played that kind of changed something in my life." Like they weren't even Christians. They couldn't explain it, but I could explain it. It was the anointing. It was the prophetic word that when I played, it would bring down strongholds. It would cause people to feel things that are different than just playing the drums if you didn't have the anointing. And I've experienced that over and over again of people telling me after they heard me play how they felt relieved, or they felt healed, or they felt many different supernatural things, but they didn't understand it as such. And they were kind of just coming to me like, "Wow, there's something about your playing." And of course, I knew what they were talking about. It's the Lord playing through me, through the instrument, right?
Yes.
And then he went on to say this thing. He goes, "How will I do it?" The Lord says, "By my provision. It shall be a family thing." So now my children are 24 and 21. And they are super close to the Lord. They have a super anointing on their life. They are both prophetic. They both walk with the Lord. They both lead people to the Lord. They're both kingdom changers and shakers and makers. And then he said, "You will not be taken away like you have, because the Lord says, this shall be done not only by your physical appearances, but by the prospering of your product. Because God says, I'm putting it on the internet, and I'm going to send it out where interest shall suddenly grow and grow and grow." So it's very interesting. Kim was the first guy to get behind my book, Soar. So I wrote a book called Soar, which is 9 proven keys for unlocking your limitless potential. I sent Kim the Word document of this long before it was out, and to see what he thought. And he absolutely loved it and immediately got behind it and said, "I want you to get this book out there. This is an incredible message. It's about discovering your gifts, developing your gifts so you can deploy your gifts." And Kim sowed into me getting that out there. He also did a big interview with me on the show about the principles of the book. So he really believed in it so much and was one of the first guys to endorse it and get behind it. So I just had this vision the other day that, to give the book away. And I'm going to give it away on your show. This is the first place in the universe that I'm going to offer it as a free downloadable PDF so that I can do my part in fulfilling that word where he says, "How shall I do this?" Where interest in your product shall suddenly grow and grow and grow and grow. And so now it's a downloadable PDF. So people from India, Africa, all over the world now can get this book to help them understand how to fulfill their call and God's purpose for their life. So if people are watching internationally, they can just go to zoroministries.org, Zoro with one R, zoroministries.org. On the homepage, you just click download the PDF and you'll have the book. If you're in the United States, you can text the word Zoro, Z-O-R-O, to 56316. So that's me doing my part to get it out around the world. So then he goes on to say here, he goes, "I am sending you as a prophet to those that are in kingship in their own kingdoms in music and all over the world." So very interesting. God has used me in the kingdoms of the music industry, the entertainment, like actors, producers, directors, politicians. The Lord has used me since this prophetic word in many of the kingdoms of the earth to minister to people in high places, including I used to travel with Paul Allen, the co-founder of Microsoft, the fourth richest guy in the world. So the Lord definitely put me in a position of influence over kings, but kings of different fields, you know, medicine, science, religion. I mean, all the kingdoms of the earth God has given me favor with. And in all these years since 2009, I find myself in these amazing settings where I'm around some of the biggest people in the world, athletes, actors, writers, and I'm having an influence on them just the same way Kim did, just by being available, loving on them, speaking over them, prophesying over them. So yeah, there is so much in here in just that one prophetic word. And then we'll listen to clip two. But anyway, yeah, it's astounding how much has happened since 2009 in terms of the words that he spoke. And I have to say this, that those words changed my life. So when you get a prophetic word like that from someone, and especially someone like Kim, they don't just, at least with me, they don't fall on deaf ears. They're like, that's what's kept me going during all the dark times when things didn't look like they're going to pan out, is those words that he spoke. So anyway, that's what I have to say about that. You guys have any comments?
Oh my goodness. You know what? I didn't want to interrupt you. I will say, your book Soar, he gave me a copy of it back then. He actually, yes. And I have it still at home. I still have my copy of your book, Soar. And so, yes, as you were speaking, that information you gave is on the bottom of the screen, will still be there for everybody. But that's just awesome. So awesome to hear that. And especially because I do remember the book. I remember seeing copies of it around the house, and then actually him giving me a copy. So that's lovely to hear that, and lovely to hear that you're sharing it that way.
Well, Zoro, for me, anybody who hears you play cannot, they will remember it.
It's
a very, you are an amazing musician. So I'm sure God is using you in unbelievable ways to reach out to people. You know, we call to different types of people. And I mean, just your ministry can reach out to so many that artistic type of people that would never listen to somebody like me or Donna.
Well, listen to you, yes.
Well, we're all called to different people, and we all use what we have to reach them. But it's just amazing what the things that he and like I said, he was the first one to read Soar when it was a Word document before it was printed. And he was the first one that goes, I want to help you get this out around the world. But at that time, you know, we didn't. Now is a time where people can download a PDF. We're in that era where you can get the message around the world, because I'm never going to – I mean, I'm unlikely that I'm going to be in India at a church next week speaking, but, you know, and have physical copies of the book. But I figured, hey, God gave me all these messages freely. It's helped a lot of people. I've had people that are dyslexic. I've had people that hate reading that go, your book was the first book I read all the way through, because it's very simple and easy to read and understand. And it flies off the page. But the Lord delivered me those words over like 3 years. He would wake me up around 3 o'clock in the morning, and I'd write from about 3 to 8 in the morning. And that's where all the words came. But then your father and your husband was the first guy I had read it. And he just was like, this, we have to get this out there. So it's just kind of strange that, like, all of a sudden now I'm back on the show, and now we're, because this is the thing I want to tell people about prophetic words, because I've had a number of them in my life. And there's we play a role in fulfilling the prophetic words that we've had. I've had many different words, but when I get them, I receive them and I believe them, even if they seem impossible or look beyond me. Like he said in the word, he goes, you felt like Jeremiah, like maybe you weren't smart enough or couldn't do it, you know, but when I got that word, I said, well, then I must be able to do it, because if God says I can do it, I can do it. And if God says these things are going to happen, but we all play a part in whether that comes to pass, one, based on our belief and based on the actions. So in a sense, I'm physically in front of everybody fulfilling my part of getting this product out in the internet where interest shall suddenly grow and grow and grow, because I'm a part of that. So some of these things don't just happen just because you lay around at the house and they're just going to happen. You, faith and prophetic words, you're actively involved. But I have this childlike faith, and when I get a word, I just believe it. If it takes me 1 year, if it takes me 10, if it takes me 25, I'm going to fulfill those words, because I feel honored that I even received them. And then I also feel responsible that if I receive them, then I didn't do my part. Well, what am I going to tell God on Judgment Day?
God, don't worry about that, Zoro. I'm sure he's going to be fine with you on Judgment Day, because we're actually going to be at the Bema Seat. You know what the Bema Seat is? That is the judgment seat of Christ. And the judgment seat of Christ is where you handed your rewards. You're not judged because you already accepted the free gift of salvation, so you're not under judgment ever.
Yeah.
You know? Well, the great white judgment throne is not for us Christians.
That's the best news of all. So shall we play the second clip?
Of course.
Okay, so now we're going to play the second clip.
Go ahead.
About my children.
I have Buddy's picture, both of them actually. I've got their pictures on my little iPhoto thing. Pray for them. Now let's pray for this young man. Here is a Samuel in the house. This is the Samuel that I was speaking about early on. The Samuel that would say, I'm going to pray anyway. I'm going to praise anyway, even if the environment and the atmosphere is bad. Because you know that you don't even know this, but this young boy has a pure heart, like David, a contrite heart. You know what that means? It means that there's a softness and a pliability there that's on his life to be able to change at any time, to be able to fit in. It's an amazing gift. In other words, he'll come in front of a certain culture and he'll do like the Apostle Paul and he'll just completely adjust to it and change. And he has that pliability to be able to just fashion himself into a whole culture. You have been chosen to be a very powerful voice in God's kingdom, but to the rulers of darkness, you have been given a gift. And as Samuel stood before Eli and ministered to the Lord, so you will stand before terror, you will stand before fear, you will stand before religion, and you will do exactly what you want to do. And I anoint you because you will suddenly find that your understanding, even in your school and your work, will be sharp. You will have an understanding of things way before your time. An acceleration is taking place on him. An acceleration is taking a place on her, so that they will advance before their time, so God can use them in a great way, and they will be educated. And as the spirit of excellence was on Daniel, so it shall be upon your children, says the Lord of hosts. Give him a shout of praise, everybody.
Wow, that's amazing.
Wow, that was powerful.
Right? I mean, incredible. So first I have to tell you that at the time, this is my son, his name is Jared, and at the time he was 10 years old, because that's 2009, he was born in 99. So he's 10 years old, so Kim couldn't possibly know anything. Well, he never even met him, so he knows nothing about his personality, what he's really like, or anything like that. He couldn't have nailed it more perfectly. My son has a heart like David. He has that contrite heart. He's probably the sweetest, most tender, beautiful soul you've ever met. He just has this beautiful, pure heart about him. But he has the ability, like Kim prophesied. Jared is the kind of a kid who could go anywhere and meld in with anybody. He could walk into a bar where he doesn't know anybody and immediately start meeting people. He's definitely prophetic. He's definitely has a heart for the Lord. Right now, he is in law school in New Orleans at Loyola University, and Kim talked about how God was going to use him in all these different kingdoms. His goal is to become a lawyer and to do constitutional law to help fight for the rights of Christians around the world. He's had other prophetic words from different prophets at different times about that he would be a statesman, somebody in government, somebody handling big, huge things. But what's crazy is he talks about both my children. He says they will have an understanding of things way before their time. An acceleration is taking place on him. An acceleration is taking place on her. So they will be advanced way before their time, and God can use them in a great way. And they will be educated. And as the spirit of excellence was on Daniel, so it shall be upon your children, says the Lord of hosts. So my daughter's now 21. She's about to enter her third year of college in New York. She is an absolute 4.0 student. My son is a 4.0 student. I mean, they are smart and educated because of what the Lord has put on them. But I've always felt they had the spirit of Daniel upon them. They have that spirit of excellence. Everything they do, like everything Daniel did, he did with the spirit of excellence for the Lord. And they are both have turned out to be exactly like this word that Kim had. And at the time, you know, my daughter was much younger and she was still sitting there in the audience. But his word was for both of them. But when he talked about how my son would be able to just fit in with any culture, that is beyond true. And he's been that since he was young. When he was younger in school in Nashville, it was actually he had a difficult time because he was so adult-like that the kids that were with him were just still kind of goofy boys and they didn't relate to him. And I said, don't worry, one day you'll grow up and you'll be a full adult and then everybody else in the world is an adult. But God definitely made both my children accelerated way before their time, which in certain aspects has made their early childhood more difficult. But now that they're young adults, they're totally thriving and prospering, and they both have an amazing heart for the Lord. And they're not just churchgoers. They, because they've grown up with Kim and around the prophetic and around me and my wife, their faith is their own faith. Their faith isn't my faith, and they have a heart to make a difference. So, yeah, these words are incredible that Kim prophesied. And again, he didn't know anything about them, had never met them, but it turned out to all be true.
Wow, that's amazing. That's amazing. You know, there's so many people that Kim actually ministered to over the years, a personal prophecy. You know, he did that for a period of time, and then he kind of stopped doing that. He focused more on national prophecy and prophesying over nations and things, but you had the unique opportunity of having a word, you know, him pray for you and having a word given to you because, you know, like I said, he stopped doing that for a while. But it's amazing to see how when he gave somebody a word and you know, just watching their facial expressions, being in an audience and watching the facial expressions of people when they hear something about themselves that they know only God knew, is very, very impacting. And there's quite a few people out there that happened to. So
I was
amazing.
Yes, definitely. 2009, you know, I would say 2009, he didn't do as many. By then, he wasn't doing as many personal prophecies. So just the fact that he called you out and prophesied over not only you, but your children, it really is a testament to how anointed your family is as well, because God was sure to grab you and speak to you through my dad. And I always pay attention to those things as well, because it wasn't as common then. So it sort of makes it more worthy of note that God called you out and your children for such a time as this, because in this time that we're in right now, like you said, your son's studying to be a constitutional lawyer. That is exactly what we need. So it's just it's made me smile and feel very happy about how things are. And I also feel so encouraged too, because anytime I hear a testimony, especially if it's something Dad's prophesied, it's important. But also the fact that who you are to our family and to this ministry makes it a little bit more special too. And it is nice to hear how well your children are doing. And your son was so cute when my dad was prophesying over him. He was just so cute. I mean, you said he's grown now, but he was just adorable. Just also his little eyes getting prophesied over. I would love to watch that as well, especially children.
We laugh now.
Zoro, you've got one of those folders that...
Yes.
Yeah.
I'll show it to you. One of the funny things, Donna, you were saying, when we watched the photo of my son, he's 10 years old, it's so funny, he's chewing bubble gum and his tongue is going all over this place. It's like, it's just it's the funniest thing. And the thing, I feel so blessed and so honored to have received personal prophecies from Kim, because I understood that he wasn't doing that a lot. That also makes me feel very responsible to go, if God singled me out, I mean, he answered that prayer from 1995 when I said, Lord, if you could make it possible for me to be friends with this. There's something I loved about him without even knowing him. Just when he was up there, I was attracted to his spirit. It was a brother-to-brother thing. It was spirit-to-spirit. And so just the fact that God brought that to come to pass is pretty much a miracle. And then he gives me that word and then the word for my family. And my son, by the way, Donna, he follows the broadcast like constantly. Like so he watches everything you do. Ever since he met him, he's always been a follower of it. So he's going to watch this broadcast and be very, very excited. And he's just like me in that he wants to fulfill his word. He does his part. But I had I understood that this was also very rare where Kim would prophesy over people. I guess he did this over President Bush and a few people. So he gave me a personal prophecy that he actually wrote out. And I know you'll have it on the screen. Yeah. And so he had the most beautiful calligraphy of anyone I'd ever seen. And he told me that he, first of all, the first scripture there is really coming to pass almost at this exact season of my life. Just the first line. When he has tried me, I shall come forth as gold. Job 23:10. When he has tried me, I shall come. I have been tried since 2009 in many, many, many different ways. And I mean by like the faith being tried and tested in every kind of way, right? And so the that particular one of the things he I'll read you a couple of the lines from it because I have the transcript typed out because people won't be able to read the calligraphy on the screen very quickly. But one of the things he says, your place of pain became your place of rain. Okay, my place of pain. So I grew up with a lot of pain in my childhood from being abandoned by my father, from being raised by a single immigrant mom who raised seven children alone. We had several different fathers. So I had a very painful childhood in terms of rejection and feeling worthless and not really having an identity. I was half Mexican, I was half Irish, but I grew up in the black community of Compton, but I wasn't black. And then we moved to Grants Pass, Oregon, and then I didn't fit in there because we were Mexican, but I wasn't Mexican enough to speak Spanish. So I was always in a lot of pain throughout my youth and my childhood. But what he said here is your place of pain became your place of rain. And that's a word for everybody if you choose to receive it that way, meaning the thing that's made me the strongest in this world as an advocate for people, a teacher, a mentor, a writer, is because I came from that pain. I know how to champion other people because that comes out of not having been championed myself. So I know what people need. I know how to rally and I know how to encourage and I know how to inspire. And that's what SOAR is about. That's what my ministry is about. That's what my personal life is about. But it's amazing. He pointed out your place of pain became your place of rain. And then he says a line here that really, really was true and has been true. Although many great things have happened in my life and in my career and in my ministry, and I'm not negating any of them, there's been many things I felt like have not opened up for me, and I was always a little frustrated by the amount of work and effort that I did. Why haven't things opened up in the way that I envisioned them? And he says, Zoro, your God has restrained you and held you back from certain opportunity and promotion, for there is the perfect time for you to go to the high place and dethrone and disarm the present rulers of darkness. So I had felt many times, as much as I had done, I still felt certain things were not open to me. I'm like, what are we waiting for, God? Like, you know, I'm 61 years old right now. But that word proved to be true. And then he goes on to say, listen for one moment to the ticking of that clock. Pause. Your time is soon to come, but wait, for there is only one clock. And then he says, you have parted with all that you possess. Which is totally true. I gave up everything to follow God's will for my life, the prophetic words, pursuing ministry. I parted with everything. He says, you have parted with all that you possess, and therefore your willingness to do this has earned you the attention of heaven. Zoro, minister of groove, God is with you, prophet. And I'm telling you this now because
Wow.
I just finished, so this is a vision God's given me for many, many years, and hopefully I'll come on the broadcast when it's closer to being released. But many different times I've had prophetic words that I would write a book about my life, a memoir that would become a huge book, that would become a movie, a Netflix series, and God would use it to tell his story of my life around the world. So I've been working on writing that for 15 years. I've been rejected over 100 times in the 15 years. And I've actually been writing it since I was 10 years old, because in the memoir, I have diary entries from when I'm 10 up through my early 20s. The memoir is extremely powerful. It's an overcoming story in the spirit of like Rudy, Rocky, The Blind Side meets Forrest Gump. The great news is that I signed a publishing deal in December. The memoir is coming out in April of 2024. And I feel like that is where the dam is going to break. That's what God was holding back, all these things, for the perfect timing. Because in that story is going to open up the whole world to me to be able to have a platform to share the kingdom of God with people in a real, relevant, relatable way that only is going to be made possible by a story that reaches all people. It's a story for all people, even though it's a God story. It's not written like it's a Christian book. It's just written as a story of faith, a story of God's faithfulness to a family. But it's also, God's given me a vision of it being a movie, a Netflix series, and I already have interest from people on that. So all this is going to happen in April 2024. And the reason I'm sharing this with people is that some words come, some prophetic words happen, and a year later, the word will happen. Some in 2 years, some in five, some in 10. But look at Abraham. How long for him and Sarah before their son was born, right? So I feel like the birthing of this season of my life has been a long haul. And to be rejected for something 100 times when the Lord said to me prophetically many times through other prophets that you shall have a book about your life, it's going to touch people around the world, you're going to have a movie, and then but for you to get rejected year after year after year is enough to make almost anybody quit, anybody but me, because I know who my God is. I know the words that were spoken. So it's up to each of us to believe what God said and to be patient. And I can tell you this too. If that book had come out 15 years ago when it looked like it was going to happen, 10 years ago, it would never be what it's going to be now. And the reason is, I developed as a writer in those 15 years. If you look at my library, I have over 300 books on writing and how to write memoirs. And I studied the craft and I worked with great editors. And also, I matured from 45 to 61. I'm a completely different man. Now I'm more vulnerable. Now I'm more transparent. Now I have perspective where I could look back on my life and really see what my story was all about. And this is why he was like, God's holding you back. He knows the perfect time to release you. And if it got published during COVID, it would have got lost in the shuffle. So many things God blocked, because now it's the time for me to really get out there. And anyway, I'm just sharing this because it's super thrilling and exciting to see God fulfill his thing. I wish Kim were still here, because man, he would love this memoir, and I would share every part of the journey with him. He believed in me more than anybody I've ever known. Kim sowed into me and believed. And I remember when I first met him, he said, the Lord told me to sow into you because you were good ground. And he just sowed every week, every 2 weeks, he would sow whatever the amount God showed him. I never have ever asked him for a dollar in my life. I would do whatever I did for him for free because I loved him. But he just said, this is what the Lord said to give. And that sustained my ministry. And it not only did it do that, it helped me to believe that God believed in me that much that he would send Kim to be a guy who helped build my ministry. And that gave me confidence to go, even if Kim's the only guy in the world who believes in me, he was the one believing in me. And I was like, I've got to fulfill these destinies and these prophetic words for Kim, because he sowed into me. And even though he left this earth, and that was a very dark time of my life, because obviously the worst time in your life, because I felt like I was in such a groove with him. We were doing so good, but God had other plans. But I was like, I am going to honor my friend by fulfilling my words and then by bragging about what he did in my life that made it possible. and by being accountable for the words he gave to me, that I could live them out, you know, carrying the baton on his behalf. So it's pretty epic. The name of my memoir is called Maria's Scarf. Maria was my mother, and it's called Maria's Scarf. It's not even ready for pre anything yet. You know, I'll come on at another time when it's closer. But the book is completely finished. The cover is done. There'll be audio for it. It's a fantastic publisher who loves it, who gets it, who wants to get behind it. So God knew what he was doing. So my word to people out there is, when you're in that period of frustration, when nothing seems to be happening, just keep trusting God. Keep doing your part to plow the land, to sow the seed, to work the soil, to work the crop. That's what I've been doing for 15 years, studying the craft of writing. Sore is one book, but the memoir is a whole nother league and level of writing. But do your part and then still be expectant that God will do his. And in time, if you do not give up, he will. And I think it's totally God's divine timing that I'm on this show now, because I wanted to show you the words that have come to pass, the words I'm in the middle of, and the words that are about to pass, that are around the corner. So when I come back and show you a year from now what he's done, you'll know I said it right here on the broadcast. It meant the most to me because it was from my friend who believed in me.
Yes. And you know what? That is just so beautiful. I'm so excited about the book too, especially now that I've listened to you today go through the whole experience. Like, I'm so anticipating reading this book now. I'm super excited. And I know when we talked before, you had told me that you were writing a book, but I hadn't really thought too much about it other than that you had a book you were working on. But that is so interesting. And the way that it's so intricately intertwined with what he prophesied over you and the word that God had for you, it's just beautiful to see it. And because we know you, it's always good to have you come back and see us. But to hear this really gives me so much hope. And you know what? A lot of people do need to understand that about prophecy and God's timing, because I've had things prophesied over me. And it's also the same thing. It's like there's that anticipation. But my dad used to say, it's the way you handle those things is like dancing in God's rhythm. So you're in God's timing, and your whole life is this dance with him, and it's staying in that rhythm. And I think that's part of it with prophecy is God's timing is going to be the best timing. Mm-hmm. And I can't think of any better time. Like you said, if you had written this book 15 years ago, there's 15 years of stuff that God needed you to include. And so I know that the timing of this release, especially that you finished it now, the timing of the release is perfect. And I think also it being that it's coming out next year, I feel next year is a very important year too. And so the fact that it's coming out next year is crucial. So yes, you have to come back. Once the book is out, because we're going to want to see the cover. I'm a big reader, and I write, and I'm going to want to read this book as soon as I can. And I'm going to be so excited to share with people what you've written, because your story is so interesting. I didn't know that you'd lived in so many different places and that your childhood was that way. I never knew that. And I think that's God does that with people because he needed you to have a unique perspective and to be able to move through cultures the way that you do. And so it all makes sense, you know, in hindsight, but understanding how to look at the future is so important. And you really helped today, I think, a lot of people to understand that because of the way you articulated it and also being able to show us the prophecies and then how this has come to pass, this is happening, and this will happen. And the faith that we need to have and that relationship with God all tying together in this such a crucial time in history right now. And I do so regret that my dad is not here, but I know he can see us. You know, he's in the cloud of witnesses and he's watching. And I know how much he loved you. He just thought the best of you, Zoro. So I'm not surprised about
Zoro,
anything.
He definitely thought you were the best drummer on the planet. Best drummer on the planet.
And to tell you how important he was to me, like, I kept every thank you he ever wrote me, when I would play on the broadcast. Aww. We went to Europe, or we went to Paris, or we went to Miami. he would send me these beautiful, encouraging notes saying, you made such a difference. Oh, right there, he said, you are a special man. Man, I cried when I read that. He said, you are a special man. You know, and then he's got his pen there. And
you are a special man, Zoro. You are.
Well, he made me feel that way. You guys did. I kept everything. I kept the little letter, you know, that he put it in, you know, and when he'd send it to me. So, I mean, this father of yours, husband of yours, was one of the greatest gifts that God gave me, and it set me up to understand who I was and my true identity and my true value, because a lot of times in the Christian community, people didn't perceive me the right way, or they would see the way I dress. You know, I wear the scarves and jewelry, and then they would not take the time to come to know me, and then they would just think I'm just this shallow guy because of the way I dress, just because I like fashion or whatever. But Kim just always saw me for who I was, and he actually saw the anointing that was on me when a lot of other people that had less spiritual awareness wouldn't see it, and they would misjudge me, and they would keep me out of things because, oh, who's this Zoro guy with the hat and the whatever, and Kim wasn't that way. He loved me for who I was. He saw me for who I was, and I can't say enough great things about how that changed the trajectory of my life and gave me the confidence to pursue all the things that I'm doing. And recently I've gone through a tough time that I've just now come out of. And so the last thing I would say to people when he had that word at the beginning of his prophecy, when he has tried me, I shall come forth as gold. So get ready that if you're going to do anything great for God, that he will try you. And what did Job do? So there's people who
us,
who disappoint us, who lie about us, who fire us, who, you know, cheat on us, whatever. We all have those things happen, right? But lately, my prayer has been, I'm praying for all of my enemies throughout my life, all of those who might not be my enemies, but people who've hurt me, or people who, you know, enemy is a strong word, but there's all kinds of hurt, right? So my prayer lately was like, I want to be blessed like Job. And part of being tried is when Job's friend said, well, your life's falling apart because you must have done this, or you didn't do that, or whatever. And they were all just telling him, curse God and whatever, and he refused to. And then in the end, God said for him to pray for the guys. I mean, you know how hard that is to pray for the people that are the ones that put you down, or that lied about you, or fired, whatever. Yeah. And so lately I'm going through my Rolodex of life and going, Lord, I pray for all those people, the people who lied about me, cheated from me, whatever, bless them all, because I want to be blessed and I want to fulfill that word. When he has tried me, I shall come forth as gold. So he's going to try you emotionally. He's going to try you physically. He's going to try you financially. He's going to try you relationally. If you want the gold, you're going to be tried. And higher levels means higher devils, right? So I'm about to go to the mountaintop, and not because I'm more awesome than anybody, but because I know that's where I'm supposed to be. That's where God wants me to be. And I want to fulfill that, not just for me, but so I can show other people the way. Many times it was prophesied that I was a forerunner. So a forerunner has to do things other people haven't done. A forerunner has to show you how to climb that mountain because no one else has climbed it yet. So I'm called to be a forerunner. I'm going to climb it. I'm going to show the people. And when Donna and Jane, I can't wait for you to read the memoir, because it's a story of a kid who lived in a car with his mother against all odds, and the world hated us. It's the most overcoming story you can imagine. It's got more twists and turns, but man, I just had a screenwriter just finish reading it, and he called me for 45 minutes to tell me how incredible it was. It's one of the best books he's ever read, and he can't wait to help me get this out there as a film. You know, so I'm just excited to share it with you guys.
Awesome.
First of all, that's awesome.
In the world afterwards, you know.
Wow, that's awesome. It's been an amazing, amazing, amazing interview with you today, Zoro.
I know, it's been so good to see you. And to hear all of this, I feel very hopeful and very excited in anticipation of what's going on with you. It's really blessed me to just hear from you today. And I know a lot of people watching must also be blessed.
We need to make sure that we've got Zoro's information.
Yes, actually, why don't you, before we go, I would like to give you a chance to tell people how they can find you. Okay. And we'll put the information will be at the bottom of the screen. But just, you know, if there's social media, how would they find the book? How do they hear you? Anything you're doing? Let everybody know quickly before we go.
So very simple. My website is Zoro with one R. ZoroMinistries.org is my ministry website. ZoroMinistries.org. And if you go on there on the homepage, you can click the download button and you'll be able to download a free PDF of the entire SOAR book. Then if you want to just text, you could text the word Zoro, Z-O-R-O, to 56316. And you can also download a PDF of SOAR there. On social media, on Instagram, I'm Zoro the Drummer. All one word, Zoro with one R, Zoro the Drummer. Same thing on Facebook. And then my regular secular drumming website with more of my drumming footage and career is just ZoroTheDrummer.com. So those are all the different ways to reach me. When the book, the Maria Scarf, my memoir, when that's going to be available, it doesn't come out till April, so I'll probably be promoting it after the beginning of the year. It'll be on both sites. So if you follow me on social media, Zoro the Drummer, Instagram and Facebook, you'll hear about it because I'll be posting things about the release and revealing the cover and all that other stuff. But thank you guys so much for it's first of all so good to just see your faces. We spent so much time together in Newberry Park and on all the different things we did and the dinners and the wonderful times we had. And it was very sad when it all ended. I have to be honest. It was such a great part of my life, and I missed those times. And obviously we're all going to leave this earth at some point. And so I just savor the moments that I had. I try to look at everything as like, you know, I was lucky that I lived in a time where I got to know Kim and become this friend with this wonderful man who changed my life, and I got to meet his family. So just thank you for having me back on as a guest, and thank you for carrying on the work, because it's touching so many lives. Like I said, my son is an avid follower, so he's thrilled that I'm back here with you guys, because he listens to it all the time. And he says, Donay said this, and Jane said that, and Kim said this. And so it's really cool. You guys are awesome, and you know, I'm sure I'm the longest broadcast you've ever had, so I don't know how you're going to cut this up. But
no, not at all. Not at all. Not at all. We always do conversations for about this long because, you know, there's so much to discuss, and especially when it comes to remembering Dad, understanding the prophetic. Like you said, your son's watching. I'm sure he's seeing all the things I'm chatting about all over the place. So, you know, God has put us all in kind of a unique situation, and I'm sure you've realized this too, Zara, is that after my dad passed away, things did change in the world. And so yeah. I think there's a significance in the time in which he was alive too. Yes. And so, you know, there's so much we could talk about, and so you must come back. Come back and we'll make sure you come back after the book is out. Maria's Scarf, I'm so excited. Everybody follow Zoro. Keep your eye on him. This is an anointed prophetic man who was side by side with my father for years, who God pinpointed him in that Nashville meeting, and my dad prophesied over him and his family, and it's not for no reason. And so I do encourage you, everybody, read, follow, watch what Zoro is doing, because God is doing great things in his life. And thank you again, Zoro, for joining us today. Yes. It was such a blessing to see you. I'm so excited for you to come back. And I guess that's it for today then, huh, Mom? You want to say goodbye?
Well, thanks for watching, everybody. We'll see you on the next Conversations.
Partnerships are vital to our global outreach, enabling us to take the love and hope of Jesus Christ to those who need it most. Our Boots on the Ground partnership program physically ministers to those in desperate situations all over the world. The Israel partnership furthers Kim's legacy of outreach to Israel and Jewish people worldwide. We invite you to become a partner today. Join us today and be part of a community that inspires hope, brings restoration to life, and often healing from the past. Together, we can make a difference, and we thank you for your ongoing support. We here at the House of Destiny are partnering with you to let our viewers, of course, know about your company. It's Beverly Hills Precious Metal.
Andrew, explain how that works.
So I'll walk you through it right now. So if you go to bh-pm.com, right there on the homepage, you'll see a form that you could fill out. And that form is very important in letting us know how we can help you. So you just put in your first name, last name, email address, phone number. There's a section that says, how did you hear about us? And in there, put Kim Clement. And then there's a portion where you could write a couple of notes down on the bottom. Usually within about 24 to 48 hours, we'll contact you by phone call. And then we'll go over everything with you. This isn't a high pressure deal. We always recommend that if you feel uncomfortable, take a step back, pray about it. You will gain the answers that you need by doing that, and come back to us when you're comfortable.
We have recently joined with you at MyPillow, and you guys are sponsoring us. We have our promo code, Kim Clement, right?
It's our 20-year anniversary, everybody. Back in the summer of, in July of 2004, when I invented MyPillow, the MyPillow, the queen size, this is the patented fill, and this is the cotton cover we use on our sheets. So it's a very special limited edition pillow. The queen size, normally $69, I believe $98, $19.98 with their promo code there. $19.98, the king size. I didn't plan this either. They just happened to be in my office. The king size is $29.98. You guys. They're normally $79.98. So you're getting the best price of any MyPillow in history. If you go to the website, too, we still have some closeout slippers at $25 a pair. You'll never be $25. These slippers are closeout. Yeah. I run into people all the time. Mike, I have all your products. No, you don't. Do you know about our dish towels that just came in? The best dish towels you'll ever use in history, ever. And when we reverse engineer a product, we go problem solution. I want dish towels that dry the things, not that feel, you know, my heart or whatever. I mean, it's disgusting. These actually work. You know, these actually work. But yeah, use that promo code Clements, everybody, and take advantage of that right now.